you for joining us tonight for our Tecnoglass lecture. I'll take the opportunity to thank our sponsors, Tecnoglass, who have supported us now for 5 years and allowed us to sustain a very ambitious program for our public series. Also, I'd like to acknowledge our partners, AIA Miami, for offering our community and lecture attendees 1.5 CEUs for each lecture. So if you're interested in those credits, you can sign with Win here at the front. Delighted to present tonight's guest speaker, James O’Callaghan. James is a structural engineer with over 20 years of experience, widely acknowledged as an authority on structural glass. He is perhaps best known for his highly innovative designs for glass envelopes, stairs, bridges, and other structural elements in Apple's iconic stores. And I just learned that perhaps our record for the largest panes of glass in South Florida has been beaten by the Aventura store. He co-founded Eckersley and O’Callaghan in 2004, which has since grown into a 100-strong award-winning practice with offices in London, New York, San Francisco, Paris, Shanghai, and Hong Kong. James received the Mill Medal for Excellence in Structural Design from the International Association of Bridges and Structures, the Phoenix Award for his contribution to structural glass, and the Gold Medal from the Institution of Structural Engineers. James is a fellow of the Royal Academy of Engineering, a member of the UK Design Council's Sounding Board, the HS2 Design Panel, and the Design South East Panel. He has taught various institutions, including Portsmouth University, and actually now holds a chair at TU Delft School of Architecture. Please join me in welcoming James O’Callaghan.
Thank you, Dean, and thank you very much all for spending your time this evening to listen to my story and adventures in glass and engineering. It's very good to be back here, to be in Miami, and I hope that I can take you through something that will inspire you in the material and also in terms of how we might responsibly use it in the future. So, a little bit about me. I founded a practice 14 years ago. We've built that practice from two people, myself and my partner, to a practice of engineers which now act globally. And I think the key thing about, you know, we're a very small practice of engineering, it's tiny really relatively speaking, but we have spread ourselves thinly around the world, but also the reason for that being that we're very interested culturally in working with different people in different places, embracing the way in which people build in different ways, and taking the advantage of those things back to the places in which we work to try and improve and innovate and continually research around our work. And that thread of innovation and research, we feed back into what we do, and that tends to be feed into the nature of our solutions and the type of work that we in turn get to work with. So it's generally around high quality architecture, challenging creative engineering, in whatever materials that may be. Tonight I'm talking about glass, but our work is very diverse, from steel and timber and concrete and everything that in between. As long as it has a challenge, that's when we're interested. So engineering, I think the sort of definition here of engineering, what's important to me is this bit about the empirical evidence to empirical evidence to innovation, because a lot of what we're trying to do is to prove things and move the dial, and at the same time with that, you have to have supporting facts around it. Whoever you're going to need to persuade, that ultimately needs to be done, and that is, in a way, the key to unlocking those things, and that's, in many ways, what we think of as engineering. So my life in engineering actually started here. So nothing to do with glass, as you can see. This is the Humber Suspension Bridge, which at the time when it was built in 1982 was the longest single-span suspension bridge in the world, dwarfed by many since then, but in 1982, my uncle lived underneath it. And so when I used to visit him, when they were building it, I became fascinated as a 10-year-old what it was to be an engineer. And the fact that this material, these incredible orchestration of material to create this incredibly efficient structure using the very least amount of material to achieve the very greatest thing is a theme that not only did I aspire to understand more about and hence to become an engineer, it's something that's very important for us today to remember that ultimately in this world in which we need to be much more considerate about what we build and how we build, it is about how we build with less. And that's very key. So after that, as I went through school, or prior to college, I should say, but my younger end of school, high school, if you like, I became much more interested in detail, and that was in the case of starting to make steam engines and the parts of model steam engines and machining them and just getting really intricated and interested in that kind of level of detail, which is a very different end of engineering to that of the larger scale. But that kind of led me very much to the sort of modern movement of engineering at the time, very much led by Arup in those days. And in this particular building, which is the IBM Pavilion, designed by Renzo Piano and Peter Rice, who was one of my heroes, I guess, in engineering and structural engineering, was about this particular project, was about this traveling pavilion that they designed for IBM. But what was important is Arup came to my school at high school and they sponsored a few of us to learn to build a little model of something along the lines of this. It was a slightly different program, but it was very much based on this building. So this building itself and the innovation that went into this building was very much what led me to structural engineering within the civil engineering discipline. So I was, again, fascinated with new materials. I was interested in the ways in which things went together. I was interested in how that sort of combination of traditional craft in wood was married with much more modern technology and what that meant to enable buildings to be pushed forward in terms of how they were considered. So that sort of led a little bit more towards my first job, really, and I suppose my first job happened to be with an engineer who was at the time very much pushing the forefront of glass as a structural material. There was no glass buildings that were built with glass structures. They were built when glass was used for windows. Glass had been used with more high tensile structures, etc., like Park Lavalette, for example. But it hadn't really been used where it was the primary element. If you can see in this particular early example, a project in London by Rick Mather Architects was about taking glass beams and glass columns and finding ways, exploring ways in which they would join together. In this instance, taking timber technology or wood technology and using a mortise and tenon joint to forge a way in which you could join a beam to a column by holding back the laminations, there's three layers of glass, holding back those layers and slotting them into each other and bonding them together in that way. So quite prosaic, really, in many ways, and quite pragmatic, but without any sort of experience and any guidance, you really did everything by trial and error and testing. And this kind of led to a number of buildings like this, but it started to evolve into more complex structures. This, for example, was the Tokyo canopy, a subway canopy in Tokyo for a project that Vignoli did in the mid-90s. And it was a very ambitious 11-meter or 40-foot cantilevering glass structure, which in turn then used these layers of beams, and interlocking with those beams were pins, and those pins were designed to accommodate the misalignment of holes in glass, all of which was kind of understanding the way in which glass was made and figuring out ways in which you could connect it together in order to create more developed structures, because there wasn't the language of how to do that at the time. So you were sort of continually trying to find ways in which you might achieve that. Now this is a very big structure, relatively speaking, for glass. It was taking very high seismic loads. And so what came from that is a number of buildings that were similar. This was the first one of any scale that I worked on, in fact, in Seoul, which took that same idea and took it onto a much larger format, in fact, for a large facade of a building for Samsung, again by Vignoli. But the lower half of this building you see in this picture is a series of horizontal glass beams spanning 10 meters between the columns, which in turn, those horizontal beams support the glazing. So you end up with these very big open spaces behind the glazing without mullions, etc. But each one of these horizontal glass beams, which is in turn was hung from the top of the building, was interlocked. It was connected with this kind of interface of a sort of pin bevel connection. I think what was important about that for me at that time was that that was the point at which I understood and started to use AutoCAD as a tool, and that was really the sort of beginning of digital design, if you like, for me. But the importance of it was very much about the fact that it freed me to really get to the depth of detail. With the accuracy that you can get with computer-aided design at the time, which was relatively new at that point, you can then really start to really get to the point where you refine details, stripping away material such that you can get to a level of purity and also simplicity. I mean, ultimately, what we're trying to do when we're looking at glass design is to reduce as much as possible the connections, because it is the connections that you see. So more about that and a little bit later. But that idea of learning about materials, reducing, refining the detail, stripping it down to the very nature of what it needs to do in terms of its pure function, was where I started to really get my teeth into this particular subject at the beginning of my career. So let's move on to glass and take you a little bit more about the sort of journey that I've been on with that particular material and where it's ended up today. So it kind of started very much with this guy around 2001, I guess, is probably the time when I started working with Steve Jobs. And it started when this was a modern device. Yes, it's an iPod. It plays music, apparently. So it was a sign of the times, if you like, really. And this particular project came my way through an architect I'd been working with called Bolin Sawinski Jackson. And they've been working with Steve Jobs on a project for Next, his prior company before Apple, his interim company between Apple and Apple was Next. And they were requested by him to consider an idea about a retail space. And in that instance, they've located this project in Soho in New York. And it was very much about connecting the retail zones within this symmetrical space in a way in which perhaps the staircase was not going to be the object that was in the way. And if you think about a staircase, generally they're quite awkward objects. So having something that had transparency to it allowed you as a consumer to visually navigate yourself around the space. So glass became the answer, or at least an option at that point, and that's pretty much when I stepped into the picture. And I started to look at ideas in which we could achieve that. In this instance, it was a very simple idea, really. It was to take a series of glass walls and span glass treads between it. Nothing clever about that. What was probably more innovative at the time was the way in which we were starting to use materials that were at that point were bonding the glass together, interlayers. So these laminates that we interlayer the glass together had changed a bit. And interestingly, the interlayers that had just been developed around this time was a product called Century Glass, and that's a very stiff interlayer that was actually designed to help prevent and help to mitigate some of the issues that have been associated with hurricanes in this part of the world in particular, where objects have been objects hitting glass, domestic glass windows or commercial glass windows, passing through and injuring people or worse. So having that stronger material prevented objects, and you know, this we were just talking about the missile test that you have for the project you've just got here in the design studio. It's a requirement, in fact, in this part of the state, in fact, that the glass can't break under those circumstances. This particular interlayer was very much fundamentally the start of that process that and changed that landscape to make glass a lot safer. What I noticed at the time was that that stiffness of the interlayer would be much more was interesting to me as a device in which we could perhaps bond glass together, or bond objects within glass, in particular metal objects, that we could then use to get much higher strength. And by doing so, we could avoid the need for putting holes in the glass. And it would be a sort of step in a connection methodology and typology that got away and stripped away from that sort of point connection and that kind of idea of having the surface broken. So these inserts, as we called them, through testing them, led to sort of something that was which you'll see will evolve over time as being pretty fundamental to the success of these glass structures. The other important part of this interlayer, as I talked about, was its strength and its redundancy. So it also meant that when we broke all of the pieces of glass, that the in this instance, a glass stair tread would still be intact. And that, once you have that knowledge and you have that kind of sense of security and confidence about the material, it allows you to take that material and use it in much more ambitious fashion. And that's really the point at which this happened. So this is just two key things that happened in those early days, which then led to many things thereafter, which you'll see today. So this was the detail, very straightforward. The vertical piece of glass is, in fact, the wall that supports the glass treads. And you can see this horizontal glass, and you can just about see this this little metal insert that I was showing in that test there, which is then laminated into glass, meaning that all of the tread and the fitting is kept within a single line and single dimension. Nothing's below it or above it. The adjustment of the tread is kept within it. So you get this alignment and purity of, purity of the detail. So that detail then found its way into a number of projects, staircases and bridges and the like. And we became a little bit braver as we went along, different types of staircase, different types of structures. This, for example, in Los Angeles around the same time, where the glass walls were hung from the floor above, allowing them to pivot about their supporting connections in seismic conditions. These buildings in Los Angeles move a fair bit when it comes to an earthquake or activity, a seismic activity. And then restrained by these rather delicate little pins at the base of the glass, allowing it to shift and articulate under those movements without breaking the glass. And evolving that in turn, different projects evolved. This was in fact in London, where we needed to integrate risers with the treads, because that's a requirement by code in London, extending it beyond that to bridges, to feature ceilings and the like, and just continually evolving the ideas. Taking those into more ambitious staircases. This was the first one in Japan, which in fact was, rather than the glass sitting on the ground as you saw before, it now is a series of panels that were strapped together using those connection types that we'd discovered before, but making it a bit simpler, a bit lighter, a bit more ambitious. Going to Beijing, where the staircase was much larger, and therefore we needed to take it into, it couldn't span from one place to another, so we hung it. Using stainless steel hangers, and those stainless steel hangers were then integrated into the middle of the glass. The connections that picked up the load were then again laminated within the thickness of the glass. So it was taking that idea from a simple glass tread and using it in a much more ambitious structure, to enable the sort of simplicity of it to be. And then at some point, you know, it was never always going to be a straightforward stair, so we had to think about circular ones. And this particular instance in Osaka in Japan, where we started to use chemically tempered glass, and the reason for using the chemically tempered glass was to be able not only to get the strength that we needed from tying it together for lateral accelerations in seismic loads, but also because of the quality of the surface. By chemically tempering the glass, we're not using the same type of heat and the same process, and by getting the purity of the circle and the purity of the deformation in the glass, we're able to get the connections to be much tighter and the tolerances to be less, and therefore the elements themselves to be smaller and tighter, all of which was an important part of that. And single stories led to double stories, and taking that idea of this instance was, for example, this was hung, supported by hangers, if you like. This instance, it was taken, well, on when you go to two floors, it's difficult to hang the whole staircase. So using a central core and then a series of beams which pivot through that central core to pick up this external ribbon of glass, to the extent that you then have this double height circular staircase, all from chemically tempered glass, and load tested on the day before that it was opened by everybody within the store, which is somewhat of a scary moment for me. Yeah, I wish they wouldn't do that. And then sort of these became, you know, quite ambitious in their nature, somewhat sculptural, I guess, in many ways. They became the center. At this point, they became a little bit of a centerpiece of the retail environment. The material itself was very much fundamentally embedded in the palette of materials for the choice of the stores at that point, representing what they wanted to represent in terms of the quality of their products, etc. It was aligned with that kind of feeling. So taking that a little bit forward, that connection then developed, and we evolved it a little bit further, such that we could laminate all of the elements within the glass itself. So now, no longer, rather than coming through this glass supporting wall, it's now embedded in it. So everything is embedded in the glass, and nothing is, in this instance, is penetrating the surface of the glass, so that reflectivity and that quality of the glass surface is maintained and not punctured. You can see in these pictures here how this is very difficult to tell in the photographs, but everything you're looking at is inside a piece of glass. And then if you take that idea and you extend it to combine it with large format glazing, which I'll get to in a moment, this is a piece of glass, for example, which is 15 meters long. So that's 45, 50 feet, roughly speaking. And every single one of the little connectors that supports the glass tread is laminated inside the five layers of glass that's here, meaning that we don't need to have any vertical joints. We can make it in one single piece and then span every single one of the glass treads between it and then embed all that glass within it. So it was iteratively taking a similar language, but improving and innovating the way in which we connected it together so we could reduce and refine that language and typology. The obligatory test for the stair itself. And then in New York, that first stair I showed was then replaced by a version 2.0 in this instance, which is what's there today. But you can kind of see how the nature of the staircase has evolved and the simplicity of it. We became somewhat more interested in ways in which we could really simplify things, and this is a great image of that, a great example of that in this image, which is in fact where we can take and use the actual envelope of the building. So in this instance, the glass walls that define the inside and the outside of the space, and use those as the supporting mechanism for the glass treads itself. Again, embedding all those elements inside the glass. No need to have supporting steel stringers or glass stringers or anything else like that. We can use the elements that exist within the space, thus reducing it further and further. Extending that to even to a greater extent, for example, this one in China, where in fact those pieces of glass are now 14 meters, so they're 62 feet, something like that, by 10 feet. And each one of those has these elements, the connections laminated in it, meaning that this entire staircase doesn't need to be supported by any steel or any other piece other than the building facade itself. So that, when we started working with Foster and Partners, they were interested in refining that further. And so each one of these started to get a little bit slimmer and a little bit tighter. So we've now got everything in a sort of linear fashion, perhaps respecting the geometry of the tread itself a little bit more. So you can see in this image how the connections themselves have become a little bit more linear and within the depth itself, but also in all instances still within the body of the glass itself. So over that time, if you can see, nothing happens overnight. So you start where you learn along the way, and you iteratively innovate, and you craft, and you refine, and you work with people that understand the material. As the materials develop and evolve, the interlayers evolve, and the testing of those interlayers and the testing of your machined pieces and the materials you use, you're able to craft that into a different and into an iteratively more interesting journey of connection development. This project in New York in 2006 was fairly seminal for us. It was the Fifth Avenue retail store, and I guess from a glass perspective, what's important here is that at that time in 2006, this is roughly the size of a piece of glass that you could make. So the dimensions here are sort of 33 feet by 33 feet, and each one in the six of these fins, or five of these fins on each, in six bays across each cube. The fins themselves were made from glass that you could get at the time. Now, the maximum piece of glass that you could get at that point was approximately 6 meters, 20 feet, right? And what we wanted to do was have 33 feet as a glass fin. So we took smaller pieces and we spliced them together a little bit like wood, plywood, and joined them into one big piece. The problem being that we couldn't make them in the vacuum that you need to laminate the glass, because the vacuums for glass lamination were the same size as the maximum pieces of glass at the time, 6 meters. So we borrowed, we sort of did a technology swap, and we in fact borrowed the autoclaves that are typically used to make aircraft wings, because aircraft wings are much bigger than 6 meters. So when they weren't making wings, we made glass fins overnight, and that's how we made that cube in New York. That then gave the industry the idea that perhaps having a much larger autoclave and upscaling their equipment would be of interest, not only to what Apple was doing, but to other projects. And of course, that's what that's how that began. So this instance here, for example, is an autoclave in Germany from Sealy. It was the first one that was 14 meters long, and that enabled us to start making much larger pieces of glass for glass facades. So this was the first one we made for this project in Sydney in 2006, which was around 60 feet by 10 feet. Again, in this instance, these facade panels are laminated with a splice idea, because we still couldn't make or strengthen the glass any greater than 6 to 8 meters at the time. So you were still fashioning it together in a way. But those joints were made fairly imperceivable, but they were visible. And then taking that idea and thinking, well, what can we do next with that? Well, of course, with that comes the need to change the way in which you build things, the way in which you ship things around the world. So that whole infrastructure around changing the scale of an element in construction also has to come into consideration, and therefore there needs to be the consideration about where the demand might come from it. You know, it's not something that Apple themselves could sustain. It needs to be, it needs to find its way into the marketplace, into architecture, in ways in which it's going to therefore be used, which of course it has today and is more prevalent, and with many more people making much larger format glazing from in different parts of the world, from China to Europe to Northern America. So, you know, with these larger pieces of glass, we were a number of projects. This is, in fact, in Broadway in New York, where and then China. And this was kind of interesting for us, because this was the next step change. We started working on a project in Shanghai in 2010, and it was very much important to Apple that we made this using only materials from China and from labor that was in China. It was part of the expo. It was around the time of the expo. And so I'd been used to, you know, working with our colleagues in Germany in terms of the glass supply. So going off to China and finding somebody that might be able to make it. Now, I came across these guys eventually after spending a lot of time in China trying to find people. Beijing North Glass, who didn't really have the equipment or the knowledge, but they had a great attitude. So we worked with the attitude, and they were able to use their mother company to create much larger tempering ovens. These are the machines that temper and strengthen the glass. In this instance, they were able to make a 14-meter tempering oven. As I said before, the maximum at that time really in Europe was 6 meters. So overnight, they doubled the size of their ability to process glass. And by making that, it meant we could then make big sheets of glass without the need for splicing, as I talked about before. And we were very much into the world of being able to make up to 14-meter pieces of glass at this instance, laminating them, putting them into a building, in this instance in Shanghai, obviating the need for any horizontal joints, minimizing the connections and maximizing the transparency. Ultimately, as you can see from this, it's very much about reducing the number of joints, because that reduces the number of fittings, and it's the fittings that you see, it's not the glass that you see. So that was a kind of journey in terms of the balance of transparency. So this kind of illustrates another opportunity that came our way in 2011. So we had our first glass cube in 2006, which I talked about, and then we were able to rebuild it in 2011 using the technology we'd learned in the intermediate time. So we were able to use much larger pieces of glass. We were able to laminate and integrate all of those connections into it, so we had nothing penetrating the surface of the glass itself. So we went from 90 panels to 15 panels, and with that, the increased transparency. So you can kind of see how from these images, how we not only integrated those fittings, this shows you how everything is sat within the glass, nothing goes beyond the surface of the glass itself, and that was what it was like before, and then that's what it became. So you get the idea of the difference in density of connections and transparency that comes through it. So it's very much important that you know, that perhaps this fascination for detail is important, and perhaps you can't really hide with the glass, and perhaps that's why I'm more fascinated or more focused, should I say, on the connection details. And I think that's something that with glass is super important. The successful glass structures and successful glass facades are more about the elements in which you connect them together with than they are the material itself. And sometimes that's not typically understood or appreciated as you go through the sort of process. So since then, we've now made much bigger ovens, and now we can make 65 foot pieces of glass. This is in Hong Kong, for example, which is for that scale. You get a rough idea about the size of them from the little people that are next to it here. And that sort of moved on to other projects we've been more recently doing, Foster and Partners, where the fitting or the idea of connections has completely disappeared, such we've got much more linear and bonded connections, or even using large door frames and creating these spaces, as is the case here in San Francisco, where we're able to use these two giant doors. By using these door frames, we can eliminate the need for us to have any vertical structure between the big panels of glass. So you end up with this playing with different mechanisms to be able to create transparency by concentrating structure in one area and not the other, in order to achieve something that you might otherwise find somewhat playful and willful in terms of this opening doors between inside and outside space. So that sort of journey over time, from the sort of smaller scale pieces of glass, the connection language, the splicing of glass, the making the much larger piece of glass, is how really in that period of time between 2004 and 2016, how the world of glass has evolved. Now, it has evolved quickly, relatively quickly, in that time frame. It certainly wouldn't have evolved that quickly if Apple hadn't been the protagonist in this mix, and that we hadn't helped them support that through the process. Now, it's focused around here, but of course now many, many people are using this technology, and it's finding its way into many, many different types of buildings, and that's a great thing. So this project was perhaps the, it was interesting really as an experimentation to find out how far we could take this distillation of simplicity. And really it was a skylight for a project in Istanbul, where we took four pieces of glass, and we were then vexed and considered how we might put a roof on those four pieces of glass, and we thought a glass roof would be a nice thing to do. But a glass roof would only be able to be done in three or four pieces, because the maximum width in which you can get a piece of glass is approximately 3 and a bit meters, 10 feet, 11 feet-ish. So if you've got to go over 30 foot, you need more than one piece. So in doing so, you'd very much need to then support the edge of that piece of glass. So there's many different ways you might do that, with lightweight trusses, with glass beams, all of which ultimately started to give us this kind of sense that they were in conflict with the simplicity of these four pieces of glass. So we felt, well, let's start looking at other materials. And that's when we started to get very interested in composites, and in particular lightweight composites like carbon fiber, used typically, and this is a great example of what it's used in the yacht building industry, for example, motor racing, where you need high strength and lightweight combined. In doing so, we were able to define something that was impossibly thin. So bearing in mind, this is a 35-foot span structure, not dissimilar to half the width of this roof, really. And you were able to take something that was then 2 inches at the edge and 6 inches, 7 inches in the middle. In a way, you could make in one single monolithic piece and create this simple plane, which had no apparent structure to it. So it's very simple definition of that kind of reductionist type work. So we went through time, and you can see this was kind of what happened. So we started to feel that less was better. And we then got to this project, which was an opportunity to expand that a little bit further. This is the campus for Apple in Cupertino, which is designed by Foster & Partners. And this little building here, is in fact, that's the car park. Kind of crazy, but it's almost as big as the building. But this little building here is 65 meters in diameter, so it's about 180 feet, I guess, something like that. And it's in fact where they launch, it's the sort of head house to a theater, which they launch their product from. So the Foster and Partners came to us and said, well, this is the kind of image, this is what we would like to try and achieve. How can we go about doing that? Perhaps we can start to look at extending those ideas we had in Istanbul into something on a much larger scale. So we scratched our heads about it, acknowledging the fact that California has some pretty big earthquakes, and figured out a way that we might in fact address this. Now you would typically say, well, that's okay. You just put a big roof on a series of columns, and that's fine. But we've said, well, let's not put it on the columns, let's put it on the glass and make the columns be the glass. We don't need the columns and the glass, so let's have just the glass do the work. So we looked at ways in which we'd then support that glass, and I won't go into that now, but it's on something called base isolation, which means mitigates the lateral forces from earthquakes and reduces the load that then goes into the glass. And then found ways in which we could marry that glass to this roof. We made the roof out of wedges of carbon fiber, stitched together on a frame, made in Dubai and shipped over. This is one piece made by a boat manufacturer in Dubai called PCT, Premier Composite. So this is one big carbon fiber wedge. Bolted all those wedges together on site in California and then lifted them, lifted the roof in one single piece. So you can see how impossibly thin this roof is, and then lifted it and put it on top of the glass. So that led to this. You can see here this construction image, really, of the wedges of the carbon fiber ring bolted together and then sat neatly on this glass, and the resulting structure was this kind of ethereal piece of architecture, which in itself has a sort of simplicity to it, but also one should note that it has power and light and sprinklers to the roof, and each one of those sprinklers and lighting is fed by a conduit that's inside the silicon joint. So each silicon joint has a half-inch conduit of either water or power 44 times around the circumference to feed the roof. So you do get this kind of quite impressive space as a result. As part of that, we designed an elevator which is a little complex in that it's a single glass circular glass cab that you enter on one side at the top and you exit on the other side. And given that the cab only has one door, the only way that that works is if the cab then rotates helically as you come down the elevator shaft. So if you ever get a chance to go there, it's quite a fun thing to rotate through the shaft as you come down. So that was that was a sort of series of buildings that I've talked about here today. And just interestingly, we found that they all fitted in the same one. That is of no interest whatsoever, other than the fact that that's the case. So after that, a few other buildings and where some other material I'm just going to talk about now, that where that's taken to. But this is in Macau, where we've taken a very, very thin veneer of marble in sheets of marble, and it's been laminated into five structural layers of glass. So these glass panels are spanning from the roof there, you see, right the way down to the bottom here. So they're going from here right the way down to the bottom here. And inside that, inside one layer, is a very thin veneer of marble. And by doing so, you get this beautiful light that comes through into the space in the day. And then in the night, you get a lot of light from the inside coming out. It kind of glows in that respect. It's a very simple idea, but it took a lot to be able to get that piece of glass to be made. And again, it's a huge amount of research that goes into making something of that scale. It's not an unusual technology to have stone in glass, but it is when you're trying to make it structural and it's 40 feet tall. In Chicago, I particularly like this space because I think it's really beautifully done in the fact that it's a very simple idea of this. The retail space is a sort of part of a public plaza. The plaza itself, a series of steps down to the river, pass through the space, and therefore the importance of that is to ensure that the glass itself that creates the envelope of the building has the least amount of interruption to that continuity of landscape and urban landscape in itself. And so we're able to take the sort of knowledge we had about these larger pieces of glass, detail them in such that we didn't need any mullions or any structure, so it just simply creates this envelope or this veil around this very simple canopy. And in Milan, very recently, this is the entrance to an underground store that was in fact, was a cinema in a plaza in Italy. And so the concept was to take the what was the seating for the cinema and shift it up one level to into the plaza, creating a void underneath it, which is in fact now retail. And that sort of proscenium then allows people to sit and gather within the public plaza. And there's this kind of entrance, which is a series of glass, is a fountain, which up against the entrance to the store itself, which I guess is in homage to the idea of, you know, public fountains, etc., that are very typical of public plazas in Italy. And in Manchester, something that's this is not for Apple. This is another project that we've finished a little while ago, which in fact is a large stainless steel cloud that sits on top of a series of vertical glass walls, again unrestrained by any structure. And in Washington DC, something recently we finished with for the Spy Museum with Roger Stokes and Harbors, which takes glass and it uses a frit pattern to try and reduce the solar energy by its orientation. A bridge for Twitter that we visited recently, the Gateway Arch in St. Louis, which in fact is a series of glass walls that are in fact tensioned down by the cantilever itself, and are in fact designed to resist blast loading. And this project in for Swire in Hong Kong actually uses these vertical tension rods in between each piece of glass. So these glass are about 16 meters tall, and we tension those rods against the structure of the building itself. So these black lines you see are a stainless steel wire, and we pull that super tight like a tennis racket. And in doing so, we can then take very significant wind loads without the need for any mullions. So you create these big transparent spaces and allows you to sort of have this feel of inside-outside space where the landscape starts to come into the or feel as if it's coming into the lobby space of the building itself. So, you know, in many ways, this is where you might see some of these large format glazing ended up, in the sort of podiums of towers, etc., where you can obviously see that in many ways that's the sort of solution for that kind of language, really. So we're seeing that more and more being its use. So what about what's happened next, and what do we see as being tomorrow's glass, as I say here? So at Delft, the work that I'm doing there is very much to collate some of what we've been doing in the past that I've just explained a lot about, but also other materials such as thin glass, what is glass going to be within the envelope of a building? What is glass going to be in architecture? Very much, and that's not just within an envelope, that's within the buildings themselves, but thinking about energy, thinking about circularity of it and how it's going to be used in that respect, its materiality, how it's going to communicate, so how it then is embodied with communication in buildings, and those kind of things, and how we sort of, and other ways in which we might make it. So the recycling of glass, what does increased recycling of glass create in terms of building materials? It's unlikely to create glass itself again, but it might make its way into other types of building products and elements. So thin glass, most notably known for what you find on the front of your phone, is a development or a material development that was invented 10 years ago, whenever the iPhone or whatever was invented, longer than that now, I guess. And it's a very high strength. What's interesting is it's very, very thin, but it's super high strength. So it's twice the strength of steel in terms of its tension ability, which is much, much higher than normal than regular glass, which means you can bend it a lot, but it doesn't have much stiffness, which is good too if you want to be able to bend it. So if you start to think about glass in a different way, rather than being flat, but it being something you can significantly warp to give stiffness and strength and form, we're quite interested in ways in which you might embrace those ideas. So, for example, using natural ventilation within buildings, rather than having things that actuate with hinges and the like, you might start looking at glass that just flexes and moves like the gills on a fish to allow a building to move and breathe. So we might see much more of the material itself being being flexible and thinking of it being flexible rather than thinking of it being static in many ways. We're also exploring ways in which you can then take thin glass, which I said is a little, doesn't have much stiffness itself, but if you can create form from it and structure from it by tying, putting it into compression or into bending to create forms, and we're doing this by a sort of process of parametric modeling, but also developing three-dimensional 3D printed connections that we then were able to laminate into the glass. So you can do that with more transparent, these are prototypes, more transparent materials. So these are all printed from printers from a printer in our office, which we then are using to tie together lots of thin pieces of glass, which then we can use to try and make objects and structures. This is an example of a pavilion we're planning to build for Glass Tech next year in Germany, and we built a prototype of it this last week in Barcelona at the IAWS, the Structures and Shell Structures Convention, because it's kind of representing that, which is using this idea just made out of simple plywood, but then modeling how that might ultimately, that these are actually pieces of glass that we formed and bolted together with these three-dimensionally printed nodes. So we're now looking to take that a little bit further, refine that, and next year build this. So it might start to sort of create a language of way in which we can sort of take the sort of access we have to digital modeling, the access we have to be able to digitally print things and create more interesting three-dimensional forms in architecture using this very thin material that relies on your sort of bending it to do it. Going back to its potential uses within sort of flat glass or other ideas is to say, well, this thin glass, it's very nice, but if you need it to be stiffer, then maybe we can laminate it. If you look on the right here, if we laminate it to plastic or to interlayers, we can build up interlayers. In this instance, it's actually century glass, and veneer it with very thin glass. We get essentially a very lightweight glass panel, and if we have that lightweighting, we can find that's very easy. I mean, it's very big in the automotive industry right now because cars need to be more efficient, fuel efficient. But in buildings, if you think about it, we can start to make much more lighter weight structures or roof structures and skylights and the things, because the structure that needs to support it, the beams and the cables, etc., can therefore be much more refined. Or possibly by taking them and making more insulated units, much thinner insulated units, which we could then use to replace perhaps the abundance of monolithic glass that exists in heritage buildings, for example, which has very low energy efficiency, and we could increase the energy efficiency overnight by putting these much more efficient IGUs in their place without necessarily massively changing the frames or even changing the frames at all, and being able to get that sort of efficiency through that process of just adding that performance. Also looking more at transparent connections. This is a slide that we developed for Glass Tech 2 years ago, based on a project actually we were doing in Hong Kong using these very large glass tubes. And the maker of the glass tubes, Precursor, was quite keen on demonstrating their capability. So they asked us to come up with something, and we came up with this folly, which was really to create this kid's slide, really. But it was really about illustrating the ways in which we could explore connections. And in particular, this was making this fully transparent. So this is a glass rod, and this is a glass curve. So now we're at a point where we can actually bond that glass to this glass using a material called TSSA, which is a Dow product, which allows us to get away from that point where we have, what I was showing earlier, these inserts or metal connections. How can we get to fully transparent? So this is something we did this year, which again, just illustrates the ways in which we might be able to make fully transparent connections. We're also looking at energy. That's a big part of what we're doing. Where's that going? Thermochromic, dynamic glass, the need for glass itself to have a more responsible or be more responsive to its environment. So depending on the light and the energy that's going through the building, rather than having facades that are designed purely for the on the basis of a particular energy performance that happens for a relatively short period of its time that it's using that it's exposed to, having something that's more responsive. So dynamic glazing, there's a lot of work going in there, a lot with different technologies, but it's quite an exciting space that allows us to have a much more moderated glass facade performance. And if that wasn't crazy enough, then there's other projects that we're working on. This one, in fact, is being built right now. This is a project in London where it's a swimming pool between two buildings. And it's actually not made out of glass. We decided, for all the reasons I've talked about earlier, about connections and connectivity, in this particular instance, because of its elevated position, we decided that we would make it from acrylic, or pretty much the same kind of thing you make fish tanks from. Well, because you can weld it together, and in welding it together, you can therefore not have these connections that give you any sense of where you are, so you get this pure sense of water levitated above space itself. So in April next year, you'll be able to swim between two buildings, and I'm sure that this won't be the last of these. If we manage to pull this off successfully, I'm sure we'll see a few more of them around. So it's not all good news, and I thought this quote was quite interesting, mainly based on the fact that we are now in a place where construction uses 50% of all the materials in the world that we use, right? If humans use, the humanity uses 50% of that material is construction, which is an astonishing number. And if you think about concrete is the largest contributor to carbon dioxide outside of, as a material. And if it was a country, it would be the third largest producer of carbon emissions beyond US and China, if you've considered concrete itself. So there's a lot to do about, we need to do about that. Building materials and construction themselves, 11% of what we do of global CO2 emissions. And within that, 30% of that is the building envelope. And so if glass has a very important role, and what we do with glass and how glass evolves is going to be very important, how much we use, going back to that very point about efficiency, material wastage, less of all those ideas, its performance when it's in place, the idea that it's more sympathetic to the energy that it's seeing and responding to, is all important for us to be able to tighten these things up. So we've got a lot of work in this area to be able to be able to respond to these issues about carbon dioxide emissions and circularity. I think that, the world that we're in right now of just keep tearing buildings down and building them again is something that probably needs to change. We need to think much harder about why we're building a building in the first place. We need to think more about when we're building them, using the materials again. So that kind of idea of circularity, making the buildings in a way that can be taken apart, put back together, or at least elements of them can be used again. And when it comes to glazing, this idea that we can't use glass again is something that needs to end. We need to find a way in which we can put it in buildings and put it in other buildings and use it again. The material does not degrade. It's going to last for hundreds of years. We've got opportunities between each building usage to improve that performance. We might even improve the facade performance on the same building as technology evolves. There should be ways in which we build that kind of flexibility into building envelope in the future. Something we're looking at is a kind of idea of kit of parts, which allows you to start thinking about that, because it allows you to start thinking about ways in which you might then use them in the future. So this is something research we're doing for Google right now, which allows this kind of generic tool, which would be a web-based tool, to select different types of grids and components, etc. Your selection then develops a particular facade typology, but within that, each one of those has been costed, is understood, the supply chain is understood, and its future use can be therefore understood. So you can then plot and map how that then gets on a building and comes back out of a building at the other end into another building. So this idea of circular economy, understanding where it's coming from, and this design for reassembly and disassembly. So these sort of three tenets are something that I'm particularly interested in as it relates specifically to glass and building envelope. There are others such as GXN and 3XN who are pretty well advanced in understanding about it as a more holistic thing around buildings. So yeah, so we've only got one planet, so we need to be making sure we look after it. In terms of engineering tomorrow, how we do things is changing dramatically as well. I mean, we've got this data is now obviously defining everything that we do, and it's defining everything that you do in terms of how you're thinking about or will think about architecture and the way you think about buildings and the way in which people use them, it's very much reliant on what we're capturing and that data we're capturing one way or another. From our position of modeling, I always say that, you know, when I started engineering was a linear thing. You did something, you calculated it, and it wasn't quite right, so you changed it and did it again, and you refined it in a linear fashion. Now we build parametric tools at the beginning of a process, and then we design things in parallel, so we can multiply the things that we're doing in a simultaneous simultaneously. And if you think about that step, from that considered approach to that instantaneous parallel approach, it's a dramatic change in both the way in which you design geometrically buildings, but also the way in which we now design buildings in terms of the math that goes into it is done in the same way. I mean, it allows us to think about a building and iteratively change it 1,000 times in a few minutes, which, you know, was never possible 5 years ago within realistically accessible tools. Refining topology, and again, stripping away the need for waste. I mean, this is super important because it allows us to use less and less and less the more we optimize, and that's part of what this process of sustainability is about, looking at these kind of crazy connections. This is what, you know, I love this image that it's something that Arup did actually as research. That's, you know, a generic connection that bolts together four pieces, but actually that's the material that you make it with, but that's only the material you need, right? There's a lot less there than there. So if you get to a point where you can print it, you're using, you know, 1/10 of the material that you would have otherwise needed. And how we then build things. This work at Stuttgart they've been doing in terms of taking carbon fiber and weaving it with drones. I mean, the concept itself is crazy to me, but, you know, this is, I guess, the future, and this is a real thing, right? This is really built entirely by robots and built completely by something that's fully optimized. And if that wasn't hard enough, we've just recently been finishing, we didn't win actually, but we got close, a project for the Mars habitat. So it's been quite fun trying to imagineer our way through designing a habitat in a different universe. If it's not hard enough doing it on this planet, trying to do it on another planet without actually having any of the material that we have to design with or engineer with has been quite interesting. But we had to justify that, figure out how to make these particular structures that protected habitats from radiation and the like, using materials that we had some, essentially, only a very small sense of what it was, given that there's not much of it here or any of it here. And then kind of putting that together in ways in which you might consider living the future. And this is now actually being exhibited at the Design Museum in London from last Wednesday. So there's some quite exciting things about what might come out of that, I guess, in the future. So thank you very much. Please, if you have any questions, do let me know. Yeah, sure.
I'm curious about the way you work with architects.
Mm, yeah.
Tell us about this, but maybe you could also comment on the shift with the Apple Store from Boland, Sywinski, Jackson to Foster. And how maybe you can tell us a bit about how they work differently and the nature of your collaboration with those different methods.
Yeah, I think that, you know, the nature of our collaboration with architects generally is always where it works best is if we can participate in the very early concept of ideas and bring an engineering mindset to evolve and perhaps release many of those ideas. And it happens very much best in those early times. It's, you know, engineering. Engineering shouldn't be about developing a building and asking an engineer to provide a solution to it. It should be about an engineering working as part collaboratively with the in those initial stages of design to make a better building. Because of all the things we've talked about, it's not just the size of elements, it's the material, how they work, and the opportunities that you have as architects to explore what technology within engineering can give to your building. So I've always thought that's always the right way to work. And frankly speaking, if somebody doesn't want to work with us that way, then we don't really work with them. So it's important that we have that interface. And I think both cases with Bond and Twincy Jackson and Foster and Partners, slightly different. BCJ are probably more traditional architectural firm in the fact that they are very collaborative and they're looking for answers, but they were very much a bit more linear. Perhaps Foster and Partners are embedded with a lot of research, a great deal of knowledge across many different new ideas about materials, energy, sustainability, and they were perhaps a little bit more active in being able to weave that together into what then became their architecture. I think also there was a shift towards the spaces at the time under BCJ were very much a little bit more technical orientated architecture. I mean, the materials were beautifully detailed, quite simple, and that was very much driven by Steve Jobs and his kind of, you know, interest in a sort of minimal nature of architecture without the sort of frills. And I think after his demise, things moved a little bit more towards spaces and people and environments for people. And I think that's probably what Foster successfully brought to the later stores was the fact that it was about the spaces you're in. It wasn't necessarily just about the rigidness of the product or reflecting the product in a technical way. So they're more human spaces now, I think, and in that respect, they're better spaces in terms of how they work as retail environments.
Thank you so much. It was an amazing piece of work.
Thank you.
I have a question about, I mean, we saw the whole technical part of the design and the pieces and all that sort of thing. Mm. But where do you build the glass? How do you transport it? And how do you put it up on the field?
Mm-hmm. The glass is built in, or the glass panels, if you like, let's just keep it simple, are fabricated in a number of different locations, Germany, China, and I mean, not necessarily on the same project, but the opportunity is to fabricate them in Germany, China, Spain, Northern Canada, or Canada, should I say, and that's pretty much about the only locations you can make it. So wherever you're building one of these particular projects on the large format scale, then you're shipping it from one of those places. So that answers one question, I guess, where it comes from. And in terms of how you put it onto the site, well, that's a pretty tricky thing. It does require some fairly specialist contractors, and we work with probably a handful, I mean, four or five around the world that generally come from Europe, and they are particularly specialist in the history has come from sort of glass and steel structures, really, from way back before we've been involved. That's the sort of craft that they've been involved in, which has led them to sort of engineer ways in which they can then erect glass of this nature, build the machines to be able to do so, and train the people to be able to do so. So it's not something that you can do easily or get any contractor to do. It's a pretty specialist work, and you know, from that point down, you get to things that become slightly less more complicated. You have slightly more pool, a slightly larger pool of people are able to achieve it. But the whole landscape's changing in that it's not just the four people now or the one person doing this. Now there's lots of people putting these things on buildings, and contractors and installers are learning and finding ways to meet those demands. So. You know, we'll see more of it. I mean, the bigger challenge will be how we deal with the energy is probably the larger challenge, really, because we've got big bits of glass is not so great with energy unless you can find ways in which you can, which we have done, but find ways in which you can kind of treat the glass and improve the glass or post-treat the glass to be better in terms of energy performance, etc. So there's always going to be that tension.
Production or or because it has to travel far, or
okay. So from an embodied
because in terms of the wall, I always understood that somehow the big glass. I mean, nowadays in building in Switzerland, it's the kind of easiest construction is basically a glass building, from more or less what I understood, because you have the kind of energy requirements that you have that are realized with the glass already. Or
No, not exactly. Right now, so there's two sides to the equation. There's the equation that is, you know, what's the embodied energy in terms of making it. Glass is, you know, uses a lot of energy to make it. We have to melt sand, so it takes a lot of heat. And then obviously transportation, if you're going to shift it all over the world, it's not great either. So, that's another issue. But in terms of what it is on the building, you know, it's most building codes right now are shifting towards a sort of window wall ratio of solid wall to glass of 40 to 60%. So 40% 40% glazing, 60% opaque, roughly speaking. So if you want 100% glass wall, then you have to make it work as well as if 60% of it was opaque. That means that glass panel has to really work very hard in terms of thermal performance and solar gain performance, which generally speaking, without more sophisticated coatings, makes that glass very dark and very reflective. So, you know, you've seen lots of buildings with dark reflective glass around. They're not that desirable for many reasons in terms of light, because ultimately what you want is, if you've got to put glass in your building, you ideally want light. So this kind of balance between light and energy is where this kind of playoff comes. It's challenging enough at the moment, but it'll only get more challenging because the codes will drive that window wall ratio to smaller ratios where, in fact, using glass will become harder and harder until such a point that the technology in glass allows it to, the technology around glass improves the coating performance and the solar performance of the glass and the mechanisms we can to do that, such as the dynamic glazing I was talking about being more responsive to glass, so it's darker when it's particularly intense sun, it's not when it's not, you know, when it's light, when you want more light in the building. So that's the area that we're now, that will be the battlefield of the next 10 years, because otherwise we won't have glass in buildings anymore. We'll just build, well, this would be quite energy efficient, I guess.
Okay.
Right.
Hi, so my question is just pretty simple. What's your favorite project and why?
What's my favorite project?
Project that you've worked on.
I think definitely the Steve Jobs Theater would be my, at the minute, perhaps the next project's my favorite, I don't know, but I think that's my favorite to date. I think it kind of, I think it's a very ambitious structure. It's a very ambitious idea, and it's beautifully executed in terms of how it was built. And it's, you know, it's simplicity in itself. So perhaps for me, what I've been trying to get to is that like kind of simplicity. So I suppose that's what achieves it.
Thank you.
Dematerialization of the building. So can you comment a bit about this impulse, the quest for dematerialization? So much energy and ingenuity is invested in making the building disappear, which is a bit of a paradoxical quest for architects. So can you make, it's a bit of a philosophical question, but I wonder if you had any thoughts about that. Right?
Yeah, okay. I think making it disappear is, I'm not sure I was really necessarily trying to make it disappear. Although maybe that's because you're absolutely right. I mean, having that building that is no building is not really a building. and it's not really a habitat, but the but I think what I was trying to do, what I've tried to do, is to refine the way in which elements are connected. And of course that has is part of the process, in that that kind of refinement is about the elements that connect it together, and then its relationship to transparency, not necessarily its relationship to overall form. I think it comes to me probably from a sort of more maniacal technical approach as to how I can refine a detail and refine a material such that it can join together in a more minimal fashion, increasing transparency more than I was thinking about the architecture itself, perhaps. Because I think you're right. There was a very good example. If you looked at the first glass cube, for example, and the second one that we did, I think architecturally there's a very good answer that it's probably the first one was of more interest because it was more granular, related to the first building, and in fact having more transparency made it less obvious of what it was. You know, it was a clearer object in its first incarnation than it was in its second. Increasing its transparency was not necessarily a good thing from the perspective of architecture as an object.
You know. Thank you. Yes, I think. Oh, there's one more.
It's not cooled because it's generally naturally ventilated. I think there's some minor cooling around the perimeter. There's no air in the roof, but it's California, right? So it has this kind of ideal climate that, you put big shading devices, the canopy essentially obviates most of the solar gain. So you've got big doors that open up and it just naturally ventilates essentially. Pleasure. Thank you, David. Thank you for coming and listening.